Do you have any papers here?
Papers?
Yeah.
What do you mean papers?
Rolling papers. I got the most beautiful fucking grass in the world. It's the smoothest shit you ever want. I got it from these two beautiful chicks. CU college chicks today.
Really?
Yeah, while we're talking, now put me on. I want to see myself on film like you. This is so beautiful what you did, motherfucker. And also, listen to this. I want your opinion on this. I'm thinking, for my practice, that I live in my truck for a while, not forever, because I don't want to make any commitments like that, man. But since I have to get out of here, I do not want to get another apartment. I want to be more of a Dharma bum now. On the road, Bob. I'm moving. I come here, I sleep in my truck, I hang out, I shoot, but then boom, back down to Reno, Tahoe, and Vegas. And here's the thing, you gotta come with me on one trip, man. You gotta take off a couple days, 2 days or something, so we can have a 4-day journey. You won't believe what you got on this film in 4 days. You won't believe it, man. If we keep doing that, we'll have, I tell you, major film. It'll be major film. Two fucking Dharma bums down shooting this, just the way it is now, man. This is the opening of our film right now. We're doing a documentary, people out there. Listen, people out there. This is you're witnessing the evolution of this journey down to Vegas. This is the student of the Harvard Yard. That was Bob Fry that was sitting there that I shot. This is the opening lines of the Zen of Roulette. We're showing these people out here how to make a small amount of money, but as much as you want. As much as anybody wants. But beware of the greed.
My name is Bob Fry. By way of setting the stage for this film, Let me say that Boulder, Colorado, during the late 70s and 80s, when I was living there, was an extraordinary place. It was a good place to study the Dharma. Choyam Trungpa Rinpoche, with the help of his students, had started Naropa Institute. His students included Allen Ginsberg, Reginald Ray, Jose Arguelles, Pema Chodron. It was common for enlightened teachers to come to Boulder. His Holiness the 16th Karmapa came to Boulder twice. His Holiness the Dalai Lama came to Boulder. Taisitu Rinpoche, Kalu Rinpoche, Sharmapa Rinpoche, Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche, Trangu Rinpoche. These men came to Boulder, gave teachings, empowerments, blessings, and talks. Zen masters came to Boulder. Josu Suzaki Roshi, Sansanim, Katagiri Roshi, Meizumi Roshi. I considered myself very fortunate to be living in Boulder at that time. I considered it a Pure Land or Buddhist heaven. About 1986, corner of Broadway and Canyon, the customer to my right, around the corner, got my attention, saying he was familiar with the book I was reading, the Diamond Sutra. He said, in fact, he had spent a whole year reading the book. With this auspicious beginning, George and I, George Dukas was his name, became friends. This film is the story of our friendship and later developments. As I got to know George, I learned that he had had an extraordinary life, not unlike the Buddha insofar as he had been very rich, had given up his riches, there was a nest egg remaining, and gone in search of enlightenment. Like many of us, he had come to Boulder to find himself.
Down here, this maroon.
Turning point, George, what was the moment when, well, to quote you, you saw that you were on the wrong path?
No. There was no moment. From the moment I came into all that money, I knew it was the wrong path. I knew it was the wrong path before I even entered the money scene.
Did you just want to try the wrong path? Did you just want to try it out? You know, you knew it was...
But it was irresistible. It was irresistible. There was no question about leaving it. It was an irresistible current that you just dove into with regret.
Nothing wrong with having money.
Money is demonic.
Well, it can be. It can be used that way, but not intrinsically.
There's nothing that's intrinsically anything.
There's power in money. There's power in having a passport. There's, you know,
no,
power in having a roof over your head. These books are power.
No. You don't need any of this. This is all lack of faith. All those books is a lack of faith.
Canyon Club Apartments, where George lived, was situated near the Sinclair Station, across the street from the coffee shop. George had a following there at the coffee shop, including some teenage girls. People liked him, even the Korean owners. And customers were entertained by his raps, which didn't change much to accommodate a public setting. And many were exposed to discourses on the Dharma as well as roulette.
There's the man, there's Rinpoche himself, Bob. This is the Rinpoche.
Alfredo, this is Joe.
Well, Alfredo, one smile.
Yeah.
I mean, we're shooting pop. This is pop, man, with Cindy. With Sandy, I mean. What should I do? He says, I've been sitting in meditation. The monk said, I've been sitting in meditation for 20 years. He said, stay in emptiness, but do not be attached to it. No, there's no difference between subject and object. Forget about subject and object. Just stay in emptiness for now. And you watch all this as matter, mind and matter. But this is all matter. Just watching phenomena, which is matter. Just turn and spin and turn and spin. It's called compassion on compassion.
Okay, go ahead, read that.
Different levels of compassion. It's homage to compassion. Observing phenomena is homage to compassion, viewing migrators as effervescent or momentarily disintegrating, like a moon in water stirred by a breeze. That's his first compassion. His homage to compassion, observing the unapprehendable, is homage to compassion, viewing migrators as empty of inherent existence, though they appear to exist inherently, like the reflection of the moon in water. This is what this whole book's about, attaining compassion. You're looking at sentient beings and you generate tremendous compassion when you realize that they're momentarily disintegrating and they're afflicted with all these problems with the imaginary self, see? They believe, you know what I mean? They don't understand the truth. So you have tremendous compassion for these migrators. Bob, you generate, you know, once you've seen what, you know, the emptiness of inherent existence, like a moon's reflection stirred in the breeze. How beautiful the way they say it, right, Bob? That's us. That's us, Bob. The moon in the water stirred by the breeze. That's how fast we are here. And it's over. What are we worried about? What are we twisted about, man? What are we going on about anything for? Huh? Man, that's what freedom is. What are you, man? I'm like the moon's reflection in the water stirred by the breeze. Wasn't I telling you before we could go? I could go tomorrow, man. I could go tomorrow. Go. Hang on to what? Be free.
Saying there.
Same, Bob.
guilt.
Yeah, yeah. The guilt, about us holding on to our guilt for our past actions, is holding on to ourself. Right?
Right.
So just drop that. Now the Buddha, yeah, I'm picking up on the track we forgot with that interruption. The Buddha, you can't interrupt the camera, you just have to go make a move. The Buddha offered chariots to come out of the burning house of the self. You know? Like we are into our chariots. Tops down, man. He's into it. He is into it. Ooh. White one's a jewel, Bob. It's a jewel. Look at it. For this. Oh, man. What a pleasant thing sitting in this, Bob. Oh, shit, with that top out. Should sit down methodically, step by step with that camera, and go into that millionaire story so it can be heard. No, for real, no one's lived like that. I mean, I'm totally involved with fantasy all day long with all my movies and novels and magazines and everything. I haven't heard a story like mine. So cool.
My daughter Jane, shown here about age 19, met George shortly after I did. My relationship with her as a single father was just emerging here from a very difficult 4-year period during which I was seeing a therapist on a weekly basis, and during which she had spent 6 months in an attention home for at-risk youths. Again, homage to Boulder, Colorado, whose mental health system provided me with an outstanding therapist, and to Boulder's September school, whose principal, already mentioned, was a Naropa grad. It's fun and joyous coming out of tough times. It was also good to find ourselves with a friend in common, George.
Gorilla?
Yeah.
You got movies of when I was 12?
Yeah.
I haven't seen those. You gotta show me those.
Show you the cabin we wanted to get up here. Wheel most of the time is jumpy back and forth, you know? Red, red, black, red, red, black, red, red. But inevitably, Bob, there is so many periods when the wheel is going very red. Like that means a preponderance of red, right? When the table's red or the table's black. Now listen to this. My method has been to stay on the color until it burns out and move to the other color. But I am not taking advantage. The unbelievable advantage when it is on the table on red and black, when there's like 4 reds coming up, 5 reds, 6 reds coming up. I'm putting down $25, right, Bob? Listen to this. This is so intense. I have to pull over and light a cigarette. It's so intense, Bob. You're listening, though. You're interested, right? When I know the goddamn thing is running 5 reds, I just know it's just, you know. Now look, you put down $25 on red. You don't take it off. Leave it there for five spins.
I'm so fortunate, Bob. I can't tell you. What you said a year ago about me is so fucking true now. George, you said, George. When I got that $80,000 from insurance, he said, oh man, I'm so jealous of you. You can practice the Dharma all day with that. You're totally free to practice, just practice the Dharma. I lie in bed like a dead dog. See, Bob, here's my syndrome. I'm in heaven, Bob. I'm in heaven. I lie like a dead rat, like a stinking dead rat. I fart out the coffee as I'm lying there like a filthy rat. I go to sleep, and I wake up, and I don't even make an effort to get into meditation, right? I go back to sleep again like a fart. And then I wake up so saturated with sleep, Bob, on my black futon, right? I wake up and I don't even, right there, and my head is on the zafu, and then I sit, and the pleasure of sitting is unbelievable. When you don't think you have to do it, you have all day to do it. No, you know, no scheduled time, nothing. No appointments, nothing. And you sit until you're exhausted, and then you go back to sleep again. You know that when you're through sitting, you just can fall down and take that Hudson blanket and wrap it around you and fall out and sleep. Do you know what luxury that is, Bob? This was a sure thing, Bob, where you could take definitely, consistently, a little money off that table to pay for whatever you want. I think I lost faith a little bit. That's what happened. My faith was shook up down there. Where else can you possibly go and get $3,000, though? To go and work. Talking to Bob Fry on the Zen of Roulette. When there's no question anymore of taking 12 units or $1,200 in one session off the table, then you're in the stage of the miraculous. And the money is not important anymore to you. The example I can give of this is Naropa, when he was a disciple of Talopa. And everyone knows that story, but I'll just go over the headlines of it to clarify it anyway. Naropa came to Talopa and brought him gold. He spent several years in Tibet working and collecting gold. The third visit, it's not that sure, but I think it's the third visit. Talopa took the gold and threw it out of the hut. And this bothered Naropa. Marpa, not Naropa, Marpa. Marpa came. I'm riding around in this blue Bentley and summer's coming. And it just wasn't, I mean, I was very wealthy. This was the height of my wealth, but still very wealthy.
And I'm living out in East Hampton, which is the elite of New York, lives out there. And I'm thinking, there's nothing wrong with my blue Bentley, right? But I'm thinking, I need a yellow Bentley for the summer. I need another one, a yellow one. And then my mind started thinking of all the different colors, you know, and I was thinking I needed about 10 or 15 more Bentleys and Rolls, just for the color. This is what the rich does, you know? I mean, they go on into like this kind of shit.
What is Kabula? Bob Kabula.
Wait, you gotta get it so you don't have to hold it. If you get nervous, that's your notion of yourself.
Yeah, well, I'm not.
So don't even bother. I mean, there's nobody here.
I wish I could. I'm not there, but.
Well, who's there? I mean, moment of consciousness where you can contemplate, you know, the true reality of things, which is empty, void, then you can never contemplate it. Continuous mean for enlightenment, man, is just, you can never attain it. It's just like, yesterday was a dream, right, Susan? But who dreamt it? Did you dream yesterday? Even though it was like a dream, right? You could contemplate
yesterday. It wasn't my dream.
Wasn't, yeah, I mean, who dreamt it? It just happened or something, right?
Cartoon, that's a good word, that is.
Town.
That's
because Bob is on the path.
That's how you got connected?
Yeah.
I would have thought it's something else. Like, I would have imagined that you'd been friends and then you guys.
Yeah, we would have been in circumstance, but I think I missed it already. Well, that was just the common ground, you know, and then we got off on all our raps and stuff. Nothing to do with Dharma, mainly women. We're always talking about women. Obsessed with women, Bob and I. Women's our default, keeping us from liberation as women.
Yikes.
We're obsessed because of these clouds of mental images. I don't know what key. Well, that's the lust. The all that obscures you from final liberation.
See, Lynn.
We were saying we needed a beautiful girl to be in the video, didn't we, Bob?
Yeah, honestly, I said that.
You know, we can tell you some things. You need like
you're both very beautiful.
I mean, that's what was needed in the.
How will we share this?
That's all we got, Bob. That's all. Why didn't we stop and get it a bottle?
We can.
Well, that's quite a bit there.
What? I mean, it's only one
here,
shot.
Both of you.
What about you?
That's too much for me.
All right, you and I will split.
Split that with her.
Your coffee, now we share whiskey. That's nothing for you. Wait, come back here. You have to give up some. All right. No.
Well, yeah, take some.
No, I think we're fine. We can always leave.
No. Yeah.
You struggle along, and it's like, I was talking about Bob from the time I met him, and I said, I can't believe it, he's just so, he really has morals, and yet there was a real, I mean, just, true, when I came in, I just blabbered. We just started, and when you think about people, when you're in a situation, and you have a context of that being a certain way, you and I, we did go past that.
I think you two should go live up there together. Philosophize up there.
And then the other night, I got home and I was, it's just like, you know, your heels kick up. I mean, just at the thought of, because Bob called me to say, he called to ask something, or could we do this, or anyway, and he said, I think we will be really good friends. And I was just like, I mean, it was like flight, you know, I mean, my feet just went, I just was flying around the house. I was so happy because.
It's great, man. Bob needs to hear.
Yeah, Bob needs this.
He needs affirmative things. Build up.
You almost look like Stalin under that light.
Trotsky.
I'm section. I know what I do.
Dusty Pope.
Yeah.
You know the movies where they come into town and they got the...
That's right, you come in to rob a bank with these coats. Now, I get...
Let's get it.
I'll get this, you get that, you guys get that.
Oh, yeah.
Really? You're taking video at school? Mm-hmm. To you?
Yes.
Really?
Working on the IOPs and everything.
On the what?
Image processors.
So really? Yeah.
Look what do you have going? Yeah.
Eat the pillows. Here. That's pretty good.
Feelings are like waves within the body, constantly changing the feelings, constantly changing in the body. So, once we see that, we just see a stream of impermanence, watching the feelings. Even though you're sitting here talking to me and Bob, right? Just, you're watching the sensations also. You're seeing the changes, but you make no, here's the secret to here's the point of liberation now. You make no reaction to it. Some guy comes in here with some horrible face. You don't go, get out of here, you know, and wait for somebody, you know, to you. You make, you don't react. See, some beautiful person comes. You're just listening to what they're saying for the moment. You're making no value judgment on anything. You're not evaluating. See? And slowly all the conditioned responses that you've had to everything is automatic. Till you realize this. Then hey, you're not doing it anymore. You're liberated. Because you can see impermanence in the body. So a pleasant sensation, you're not going to run after that because you know it's going to pass. Are you going to be an actor? You know you can't hold on to it forever, right? I mean, so you're not running after anything. It's not that you're renouncing anything.
Mm-hmm.
Knowledge is shown. And weeping when it wilts in the afternoon and crying and sobbing all over the place, ray of impermanence. That's the spiritual way right there.
Just
doing with that bag? Get rid of that stinking bag, man. We're discussing profound shit here. Come over with that rattle-faced bag, interrupting the severe discussion over here. Rattle object. They're all married up there in the doors. They're beautiful, some of them. Oh, yeah. They're so...
My rapport with Susan in the following weeks waned until we weren't seeing each other very often at all. At that point, George asked me if it would be okay with me if he should... get closer to her, and I said okay. They hit it off, and he moved up to Nederland and moved in with her, and I got the opportunity to practice non-attachment, non-jealousy, non-clinging, not always successfully. What else do I remember of that period? Well, I recall Susan rolling her Bronco once, coming down from Nederland and being unhurt. The next thing I remember is of a romance developing between Jane, my daughter, and George. They got married. This relationship took me very much by surprise. About this time, I moved to Washington, D.C., so I missed out on later developments with Jane, with George, with Roulette, with George's investments. And I'll let Jane tell about that chapter.
My name is Jane Fry. I met George when I was approximately 16 years old, I believe. George and I were friends for a number of years and became romantically involved a number of years into our relationship, and at the point that our romance took off, George had about approximately $75,000 in insurance money he had acquired from a bad accident where he shattered his leg falling off of a balcony in New York City. He had that invested in a company by the name of Olivetti, which was a typewriter company. And from that money, he collected dividends on a monthly basis, which I want to say totaled somewhere in the neighborhood of $5,000 or $10,000 a month that we would go pick up from the Olivetti company in Denver, and then we would proceed to go and blow it. Oh. and one of our favorite pastimes was traveling, and we frequently, George had at that time, I think, the very first Ford Explorer in Boulder, Colorado. Right after they were first released, and we would frequently sleep in the back of it, which is why he bought it in the first place, because it was the only vehicle at the time that was long enough. Another trip we took on a number of occasions was to Las Vegas, one of George's favorite destinations. And We stayed a couple of nights in the desert in the truck, and then a few nights in George's favorite casino, which was the the Mirage. And on one of these trips, I recall, I was staying up in the hotel room because I was never, and still am not, a big fan of casinos or of gambling. So I would stay in the hotel room watching television and ordering room service and spending George's money. While George would be down. I think I ordered cappuccinos an awful lot. But I think the relationship between you and he, myself and he, the triangle, the relationship that the three of us shared going up in the mountains to Glenwood Springs and whatnot, none of that was by accident. I think we were destined to meet, and the connection was just too strong to call coincidental. I felt a very strong kinship to George the very first time you introduced me to him, and that always remained. But we did not begin a truly romantic relationship until I had moved back to Boulder and had started at CU, and I was approximately 21. On future visits, we would stay in the hotel at the Mirage, and George would go down and gamble. On one occasion, George came up to the room, and I recall he looked, I had never seen George lose his cool until that point. He looked visibly shaken, and he informed me, he said, "Sweet pea, I've just lost a hell of a lot of money," and I don't recall what the figure was. And he said, "You know, you need to come down. I need emotional support. I've got to win back what I just lost." And I went down, and to summarize the story, finally, he placed one bet for the entire amount that he had lost, and I want to say it was somewhere in the neighborhood of, I want to say, $2,000 to $5,000 that he had lost, and he, in one bet, was going to try to win back what he lost. And he said, I remember, he was shaking. He was absolutely shaking. I had never seen him like that. And I don't know what he bet. He used to always try to explain to me playing the field. I guess it was, he probably was playing the field, and on one bet he hit and he won it back. And he got him luck. And I remember he said, "Okay, let's go." And we left right then and there and drove back to Boulder.
When I first met George, I was hanging out in a ice cream store in Astoria, New York. We'd go in there and get our egg creams and whatever, hang out. I was 15, 16, that age. And George was 19, and he was much different than your normal run-of-the-mill rock and roll kid. He had his apartment within his household in the back, which is normally where, I guess, the kitchen was, but he had his apartment there. And one day he took me home to his place and brought me in the back of the house. And I never got up to the top of the house. It was in the back, and the whole place was black. And I said, "Turn on a light." And he said he didn't turn on lights, that this was his cave, and this is where he lived. And for days on end, he would play classical music and lock himself in to this place. And hadn't seen each other for quite some time. until one day, we're both at a seminar at Naropa Institute. Friday evening, when we all assemble, there must have been about 45 people at the workshop. I see this fellow walk in with a different kind of shirt. It was like one of these boatman shirts. But there was something about him that I couldn't get my eye off of. And he was looking at me. And I'm saying, you know, what is going on here? But at the end of the lecture, he's sitting in back of me. He taps me on the shoulder and says, "Do you recognize me?" And I said, "No, I don't know who you are." And he says, think. Who am I?" And I said, "I don't know." And he said, "Astoria?" I said, "Oh my God, it's George. George Dugan." After the seminar, it was my birthday, and he says, "Come on, I'll take you to, let's go get something to eat." So we go to Boulder Mall, and he brings me to the Russian Tea Room, which was a really elegant little Russian tea room. And he sits down in the manner of a king. He's ordering the head of the shop, the man who owns it, "Come, bring this woman champagne, bring this woman cake, whatever she wants." It was closing at the time. George says, "Keep it open for her, keep it open for us. I'll pay you whatever you need, you know." So we're sitting there for a half an hour, you know, past closing time and everything, and the man gives us the check, and he takes out this roll of bills. I mean, there must have been thousands of dollars in the roll. And he peels off 100 and he throws it down, you know. And he says, "Is this enough?" And they said, "Oh, well, we don't have change." He says, "Don't worry about it. This is her birthday. Celebrate." So I said, "Wow, this is incredible. You know, what's come over George? What's come over George?" Has he, you know, because I never knew that he was wealthy. But I hadn't realized that until he started telling me about the life he had in Monaco and all of the wealth. And I said, "Well, why aren't you there enjoying all this money and all this, you know, living the life?" And he said that he realized that at some point that this wasn't working. This isn't the way. And he went down to Florida, where his mother was, and he took his Zafu cushion and he sat. He knew nothing of disciplines. He knew of it, but he didn't have any teacher per se at that time. And he just knew that you had to sit. So he said he would sit until his legs were like paralyzed. And this was his way, you know. And he learned how to sit. His mother passed away. And I know he loved his mother dearly. And he was put into a space where he wanted to find the way. And he came up to Boulder and knew that Tongpa was the way. The teacher was, without a doubt, the most incredible teacher of Western society. I mean, and I think that we all, as a family, have come together in Boulder.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Like, I have...
Honey, George and I would pick up each month in the way of, I guess you'd call them, dividend checks from Olivetti. And I want to say maybe it was 10% of the $75,000 he had invested, which would have been $7,500 per month, that we would pick up and then run right straight through. And at one time I was just recalling that George had said to me, "Do you know, Sweet Pea, we went through in the past 3 months, I want to say it was in the neighborhood of $50,000. And honestly, we didn't do anything terribly extravagant. We just, we did stay in hotels. We did go to the finest restaurant. They did buy me some very nice clothes. I had some beautiful clothes. Very, what I wouldn't give to have clothes of those quality again. You know, all European stuff. That I was never so well dressed as. The tragic part of the story, which is ultimately that George lost all of his money. And that happened 6 months to a year into our extravagant spending that Olivetti went Chapter 11. And George lost all the $70,000 he had invested in the company. And I remember after that, everything changed, you know. And I was so young and naive at the time, I couldn't understand his devastation. I used to go over to his apartment at Canyon Club, and I mean, he was laid out depressed. And I, you know, I mean, when I think back on the way I was thinking at that time, I was really like a child. I didn't realize, you know, the magnitude of, you know, the effect it has when you suddenly overnight, you know, are penniless. You know, you go from one extreme to the other overnight. And he, for the rest of the time that I knew George and had contact with him, from that point on, he was really a changed man. He was went into a lot of deep depression. And you know, and I remember I used to, you know, kind of be like, George, snap out of it. And he'd be like, you don't get it. No more fun. No more hotels. No more nothing. And it's gone. You know, and it was sad. And, you know, overnight he had to start thinking about things like getting a job. And then, you know, I recall him saying to me, you know, Jane, I've never really worked. You know, I've never really had to make a living. You know, it was all new to him. And he was utterly devastated. But he was sleeping in a truck. He, of course, no longer had the Explorer. I assume it was repossessed because he couldn't make the payments on it anymore. And he then managed to get a cheap truck. It was a, I think he wanted, I want to say George used to call it the banana boat. Yeah, because it was yellow. It was a hideous shade of yellow. Ah, the evolutions of George's vehicles. I have to say that George became, at that point, an even more intriguing character. We were briefly married for 1 month. We had it, I don't think it was an annulment, I think it was an official divorce, just a month after we were married by a justice of the peace in the Karmazong Dharma Center meditation hall. Boy, that was great. That was a great moment. That was a beautiful,
I forgot that.
Yeah, that was a beautiful little wedding. And we both looked very handsome. as we headed over with our brand new, George purchased himself a wedding band, me, my...
Now, this was before the losses.
Yes. Yes. This was in the heat of the very early stages of our romance. And we, I mean, immediately George would say to me, we have to get married. We have to solidify, you know, this great... he was a romantic. There's no question. He had a... he was far more romantic than I was at the time. I mean, he was a real romantic. And, in fact, I think that kind of romance only comes really with age. But I can look back now and see how... I mean, I thought it was romantic at the time, too, but I was... relatively inexperienced to realize just how romantic it was, but now I can look back in hindsight and see how, you know, really magical it all was. So after we were married up in the Karmazong Center, we went right over next door, not a block away, to the Hotel Boulderado, and we sat in the lounge and we had a champagne cocktail or two, and then we took a room in the Hotel Boulderado, and that was our honeymoon. And then a month later, after I got to know George, after the money loss, and after he curtailed heavily his alcohol and pot and caffeine use, then in fact, when George wasn't under the influence of all these drugs, he was an entirely, you know, different individual. You know, he was a much more sober character. He became much more serious, introspective. The karmic lesson he was meant to learn was that in order to take his Dharma practice, he had to, I believe George knew all along. I mean, I believe subconsciously he knew all along that the money was destined to run out. I mean, he knew that there was risks involved in investing that money. A company doesn't pay the kind of dividends that George and I were collecting on a monthly basis unless there's a high risk involved. In order to really do the Dharma practice to the degree that he wanted to take it, which was all the way to bodhisattva, you know, yogi, if you will, you know, essentially penniless and, you know, living in a car. He had to lose everything. He had to lose the money. The whole plan, I mean, if you really trace the evolution of George, he came to Boulder and he told you, I had to get out of that scene. I had to get away from the money. How could I really practice the Dharma with all that money at my fingertips? You know, and so he comes to Boulder, partly to get away from the money. And just when I think he started to lose the money that he had from his marriage, he has that accident. I don't think that was an accident, falling off the balcony. I think he started to freak out a little bit. It was the first time in his life he was really starting to not have any money. So he flung himself over a balcony, you know, and broke his leg to collect some money. And then, what's the first thing he does? He invests it in a high-risk, highly volatile situation where ultimately he could lose it at any moment. Meantime, he lived it up. until it was gone. And then when it was gone, you know, he was forced to follow the path which ultimately he will have told you all along he was on, which was to get away from the money, to get away and to become more and more of a hermit, of a yogi.
For many years, I didn't have any idea where George was, and then I heard that he was in the monastery in, what was it, Tremper,
mm-hmm.
New York.
The Zen.
And then latest thing, I heard from you that he had passed.
Well, about a year ago, two years ago, I got a pamphlet of the Dharma shop from that monastery, got the phone number, called them, and they had said that George had just left, that he was living there. And that coincides with the monk who called me.
Okay.
And he had just arrived, met George, who greeted him. So he looked to George like an elder, I guess, because he was younger. So when I called the monk 2 years ago, they said George just left, that he was living there, but he moved up the road and was living with some practitioners who, I guess, gave him room and board. And then I sent a letter asking them to give it to George when they saw him, because they would see him in the market, in town, here and there. So, but I didn't hear anything until the monk called and said, "Are you Nancy Fu?" Because that's what George used to call me. "Nancy Fu, where are you?"
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I said, "Yeah, I am." He says, "Well, you know, he left a message. If you're Nancy Fu, I'm sorry for not getting back to you all this time. I just found your letter and wanted to let you know that George had passed, and that if you want further information, to call him." So I called him, and he spoke kindly of George and great sadness that he had, the monk had just come to the place, not being a monk at the time, and met George. They had the housing together and disciplines together, but then there was a point a year or so ago where George said he was leaving, because the head monk said to George, "If you don't follow our rules, you have to get out. We can't have you stay here." So he left. I guess he got sick, he got cancer, I don't know what kind of cancer, but he ended up in a hospice, and I had given you the information of the lady who was a social worker who got him into the hospice and was the one who would go back and forth looking after him. And I think that she was the one who set up the funeral and burial in St. Mary's Cemetery in Kingston.